Oh, I have bad days, and I have hills to climb. Then I have sad days, and then a weary mind. Yet when I look about and I think these things aloud, all of the good things outweigh the bad things, I can't complain. This world could be. He's so good to me. His Spirit came to me and gave me victory. God is so good to me. I can't complain. Sometimes the clouds hang low, and I'd like to see them go. Then I ask the question, Lord, why so much pain? What's best for me?
Yes, it does.
Although I cannot see, I just say thank you, Lord. I can't complain. God is so good to me, I can't complain. My God is so good to me, I can't complain.
Praise you, God. Amen.
Amen.
Oh, I love this song.
He left the splendor of heaven. The lonely hill of Golgotha, there to live.
and happy Sabbath. We are here. The Lord brought us through another week. It's a little foggy and rainy outside, but we know that the sun will come through in each of our hearts and get us going and get us revved up for this Sabbath, for the Sabbath school study we're doing today, and for the lesson. We are here at the Gary Mizpah Seventh-day Adventist Church, pastored by Dr. Michael Horton, and under the auspices of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Thank you all for being here. Let's start today with prayer. Go to prayer before we do anything else. Shall we bow our heads? Dear Father, we thank you so much for bringing us through this week safely when so many didn't make it. We thank you, Father, for our lives, for our movement, for everything you've given us. We pray, Father, that you will be with us through this Sabbath school, that we can take away some nugget of the lesson, and it is a dynamite lesson. So we thank you, Father, for being with us, for guiding us, keeping us, and helping us to participate in this study. In the name of Jesus, I pray, amen.
Amen.
This morning, we are going to do the mission story first. Then we will have a selection, a musical selection for you. And then Elder Lisa Boone will come forward with the lesson. So I'm going to go over here and sit down while we go through our mission story. Thank you all for being here.
World Mission Report. Gospel Goosebumps. Shakuntala felt chills running up and down her arms as the chords of a majestic melody reached her office. It wasn't the first time she had been disrupted by the music while working at the advertising agency she managed in bustling India. But this time, Shakuntala couldn't stay still. She walked to the window to investigate where the music was coming from. Peering out of her office window, she saw people coming into and out of a building and felt the urge to go and see what was happening. Slowly, Shakuntala left her office, took the elevator, crossed the street, and arrived at the building from where the music emanated. "May I come in?" she asked, and a kind man welcomed her to enter and make herself at home. It was a Seventh-day Adventist church. There was a worship service going on, and Shakuntala tried to understand why she felt those goosebumps. She returned the following few Saturdays and began attending the sermons preached by the pastor. One Sabbath, she discovered that the songs that touched her most were "The Old Rugged Cross" and "Be Still My Soul." Soon, Shakuntala learned about not having other gods, and when she got home, she disposed of all the pictures of the other gods she had. Saturdays became a sacred routine for Shakuntala, a ritual of spiritual awakening that soon encompassed her entire family. Following immersive Bible studies, the family collectively surrendered to the embrace of Jesus, and Shakuntala emerged as a fervent Adventist within the church's vibrant community. Today, at the age of 84, retired but not weary, Shakuntala attests to the Christian songs that still evoke chills, a testament to the enduring impact of the gospel. Part of this quarter's offering will help build a new English Central Church for Shakuntala's congregation in Bengaluru, India. Let's be generous with our offerings.
The song that you're going to hear is we have so many things in the Psalms that tell us about God. Everything in the Psalms is about God.
Amen.
So this particular song will tell us about what's to come, what we have to look forward to for our hope in God. So Brother Thomas will get it on the screen for us momentarily. And I thank you for listening. But while we're waiting, I wanted to tell you all, my cousin Pam was in the hospital recently for surgery. They sent her home day before yesterday, and last night she had some more issues, so now she's back in the hospital for a second surgery, and they have her intubated. And they said her vitals are doing very well, so I'd like to ask you to keep her in your prayers. Pamela Edmonds, thank you. Oh, No More Night. Okay. Okay, I can stay here and talk and keep you interested. We know the study is going to be great because Elder Boone, with the help of the Lord, is doing it, and you know she always gives us many nuggets, but she will need your participation. She's going to be asking you questions. She's going to be laying things out there for you, so I ask that you please help her, support her in this, and we just thank you all again for being here. Thank you.
Is the praises
I just love that song. It paints a real picture of what we can expect, what we hope for, what we've been promised. No more night, no more tears, no more dying. That was David Phelps, in case any of you were wondering who that was singing. So I'm going to turn it over now to Elder Lisa Boone for the presentation of the Sabbath School lesson.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. That was a beautiful song, and it took me to Revelation 21, where it says, "And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There should be no more death, no more sorrow, no more crying. There should be no more pain, for the former things have passed away. No more night." Amen. That was an excellent song. Thank you so much for that. All right, today we're going to delve into lesson four. And lesson four is about the Lord hears and delivers. Are we ready for that?
Amen.
All right, let's have prayer. Dear Lord, we're just thankful for the life that you have given us, Lord. We are just thankful for every new beginning, not only at the beginning of a new year, but throughout the year. You give us fresh revival, fresh thoughts, fresh just newness of life as we align ourselves with you. So we ask, Lord, that you'll touch us in a special way as we delve into your word, Lord. Let us understand more than we did when we came in, Lord, and let us not be the same. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
All right, as I said, we're doing lesson four, the Lord hears and delivers. Let's all read together our memory verse. And our memory verse is taken from Psalms 34:17. And let us begin. The righteous cry out, and the Lord hears and delivers them out of all their troubles. All right. So as we look on Sabbath afternoon, the author highlights some things. The Psalms highlight the truth that the sovereign Lord who created and sustains the universe also reveals himself as a personal God who initiates and sustains a relationship with his people. That's good news. There's a perfect balance between his authority and his ability to be very personable to us. A lot of times when you think of people in authority, you think of people who are untouchable, people who you have to get special privileges to be able to come into their presence. But the God that we serve, he's wonderful, he's awesome, and he's the creator of everything. Nature obeys him. And with all of that sovereignty, he still knows how to stick closer than a brother. Amen?
Amen.
Okay. So in this, in today's lesson, we'll discuss how we are not forgotten by the Lord, especially when we experience adversity. This lesson is helpful in helping us understand that in all of God's magnificence, he is not distant or far from his children, nor from our daily experiences. Amen?
Amen.
Okay, let's go to Sunday's lesson, unless someone had something they wanted to add to this thought on Sabbath afternoon. Okay, so we'll move over to Sunday's lesson. My frame was not hidden from you. I'm going to read in your hearing Psalms 139, 1 through 18. That's one of the texts that the lesson encourages us to read. Psalm 139, 1 through 18 goes, "O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know my sitting down and my rising up. You understand my thought afar off. You comprehend my path and my lying down and are acquainted with all my ways. For there is not a word on my tongue, But behold, O Lord, you know it altogether. You have hedged me behind and before and laid your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high. I cannot attain it. Where can I go from your spirit? Or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend into heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in hell, behold, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me. If I say, surely the darkness shall fall on me, even the night shall be light about me. Indeed, the darkness shall not hide from you, but the night shines as the day. The darkness as the light are both alike to you. For you formed my inward parts. You covered me in my mother's womb. I will praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are your works, and that my soul knows very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in secret and skillfully wrought in the lowest parts of the earth. For your eyes saw my substance being yet unformed, and in your book they were all written, the days fashioned for me, when as yet there were none of them. How precious also are your thoughts to me, O God. How great is the sum of them. If I should count them, they would be more in number than the sand. When I awake, I am still with you. Amen. When we look here, our text is saying, how does this text poetically depict God's power, his presence, and his goodness? Let's start with power. Looking at this text, how does it depict God's power? What do you get from that? What do you see about God's power in Psalm 139, 1 through 18? He knows what? You said he knows everything, okay? So he's omniscient, amen. What about his presence?
His presence is always with us. We don't never need to fear. Like, we may not have another human being around us, but when we have the Lord with us, he's always near, so we don't have to worry. The other thing that I picked up is that he knows how we're made. And having worked in OB for over 30 years, I've seen many an ultrasound. And you sit there and you point out to the parents, the face, the eyes. A lot of time you can see the baby's movement when they get to a certain stage. And then when we watch them sometime, we can watch them like make urine, we can watch them move around, flip around. And some babies, when they're trying to get certain things, especially when the parents want to know the sex, the kids will flip on the ultrasound tech every time because they're not giving up nothing until they come out. So the parents go, babe, I can't find out what it is. The baby's like, when I show up, you'll know who I am.
Amen. So the God is God, our God is omnipresent. What about his goodness? What can we say about his goodness? Is everlasting. Anyone else?
He provides for us.
Anything else?
Yes, he's always with us. We are not always with him. We have to be prayerful at all times. So to recognize him, he's already. He's only a whisper away. No matter whether we are in trouble or out of trouble, he's always there, but we fail. We have to recognize him.
That's
so
the truth.
This is one of the big things in our life today. We fail to recognize him, his presence in our life.
Amen.
And I like to add that each day is so different. He provides us with a new day. Nothing is the same as it was the day before. And he's always there to please us. He always wants to do for us because he loves us so.
Mm-hmm.
This psalm really resonates with me because He knows me better than anybody else. And he understands me even when I don't understand myself.
Mercy. Yes.
Sometimes we go through different transitions and stages in our lives, and different things happen to us. And it would make us question our own faith that we have in God. But he assures us in this psalm that he's with us. Even when we don't understand what's happening around us, he knows and he understands, and he's there to hold us up.
Amen.
And so that's what I like about this psalm. And when he says we're fearfully and wonderfully made, he didn't make me to be like anybody else. I'm who I am. I'm not saying it's the best, you know, but it's the best that I have to offer.
Amen.
And so that makes me feel that I'm special to him. And so when you think that you are not special to him, read Psalms 139.
Come on.
Because we wouldn't be special. He wouldn't have created us if we weren't special
to him. Exactly. He wouldn't have left everything and gave up everything if we weren't special.
Right.
Amen. Amen. So his goodness, we get what this title means about our frame. He knows our frame and remembers that we are dust. He will not leave his children who put their trust in him. He understands every circumstance of our life. He is acquainted with all of our sorrows and our griefs. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son to die that he might redeem man from the power of Satan. This shows how much he values our lives, even as Sister Ledbetter brought out while in the womb. God designed man as his crowning work of his creation. We were created to express his thoughts and reveal his glory. Amen?
Amen.
Can somebody read the last paragraph on Sunday's page? The last, as the one.
As the one who knows all about us, God can help and restore us. The fresh realization of his greatness prompts an outburst of praise and renewed trust in the psalmist. He welcomes divine scrutiny as the means that can remove from his life anything that troubles his relationship with God.
Amen. He welcomes divine scrutiny as the means that can remove from his life anything that troubles his relationship with God. So we need God. We need God when we are feeling despair. And we have those days, and I can say that I am guilty of it, that things can be so rough, I don't even want to pray. But I know I need to, and I know that I trust the Lord. And even when I know I can't even pray or utter the words that need to be said, the Holy Spirit takes them up to heaven in a beautiful language that heaven understands. I just thank God because he covers it all. All we have to do is just call on him, lean on him, align with him. Amen? Now in the green box, did anyone have anything they wanted to add to this? Sister Radcliffe.
When I was reading Psalms 139 and got to the verse that says, and in your book were all written the days that were ordained for me, when as yet there was not one of them, it made me think about the fact that Hezekiah prayed and asked to not have what he was going to die. And God changed his mind. God gave him 15 more years. Mm-hmm. And so it made me think, you know,
Some things God has for us that he doesn't give us because we don't ask.
Amen.
And in his goodness, he has all of these additional gifts and blessings that he wants to give us, and he's just waiting for us to ask for these gifts. Not just gifts of longevity, but just blessings throughout the week, blessings throughout our day, that because we don't think about how much he wants to bless us and how much he loves us and he wants to give us good gifts, that we don't even think to ask. And how much we're missing out on because we're not trusting in him enough or thinking about his love for us so much that we can say, Lord, give me this, or may I have that, even though it seems like I'm not going to get it, or I may not deserve it, or whatever is in our mind. He only wants good things for us. That's part of his goodness.
Yes, yeah. And what you said reminds me of something, and I believe Elder Finley, you shared this some years ago. It was like a thought. It was about a person who had made it to heaven, and his guardian angel was taking him around through the mansion, showing him all the beautiful rooms and everything. But he kept noticing one room was locked. It was bolted. And as he's going through and seeing the beautiful mansion and seeing everything, he finally asked the angel, "What's in that door?" And the angel, he, with sadness, said, "This is the room." And he opened it up, and it had all the gifts that were not asked for from heaven. So, you know, yeah, that's true. If we don't ask, we don't receive. So God is good. God is good. Let's look at the green box. It says here that some might find the fact that God knows so much about them, even their darkest secrets, a rather frightening thought. Why is the gospel then our only hope in situations like this? Does anyone have anything? How can the gospel help when you know you've done some things in your past that you're ashamed of? You're like worse than Mary Magdalene. How can the gospel help, Sister Ledbetter?
If we all think about it and the Lord were to take the cover off of all of our lives, everybody would duck for cover because you don't want nobody to know certain things you've done. But because God so loved us, he loved the world, Christ covers those sins. He's the only one who can really take thoughts to about certain things that have happened in our lives or whatever. Mm-hmm. And so therefore, because of his blood, Christ knows everything, and we can trust him. He's restored us. He's redeemed us. Our salvation is in him. So therefore, we can take things to him, and we can know that the gospel is our only hope. He truly loves us, and that's the only person that never will abuse us.
Amen. Amen. Anyone else? Okay. So, yeah, the gospel gives us hope. It gives us hope, and it lets us know that in our hopelessness that we may find ourselves in from time to time, there is a God who is willing to bring us out of that hopelessness. The gospel is the good news that tells us that we have a Lord and Savior who gave up everything to save, if not all of us, even if it was just one. So we were speaking in our teachers' meeting this morning. If it was just one person, he still would have stretched his arms on that cross and died. That's the good news of the gospel. It's for anyone who will accept it. You can never out-sin God's ability to forgive you. I used to tell my son that all the time because he would think he was the black sheep. He was beyond. I'm like, you can't out-sin God's forgiveness. He loves you. All right. Let's move on to Monday's lesson. Assurance of God's care. Okay. How is God involved in our daily affairs? And I want to assign two readers, and one is Elder Finley because I know she has her clear word. Sister Finley, I'll have you read second. But I want you to read Psalm 121, but I want someone else to read before her Psalm 55:22. Psalm 55:22. I want you to go second, Sister Finley.
Psalm 55:22.
Yes.
Cast thy burden upon the Lord, and he shall sustain thee. He shall never suffer the righteous to be moved.
Amen. Psalms 121, clear word.
Do you want me to read all the verses?
Yes. There's eight of them. You want me to read half?
No, I don't have a problem.
Okay. Okay.
Okay. Psalm 121.
Mm-hmm.
Do I look to the mountains expecting my help to come from them? No. My help comes from the Lord who made the mountains. He will not let you slip or fall, but will be there to hold your hand. He never slumbers or sleeps, but watches over his people day and night. The Lord is your keeper. He shades you from the blazing sun. The sun will not hurt you, and the moon will not influence you. The Lord will help you so that you will not fall into evil. He will preserve your soul. Verse 8, he will watch over your comings and goings as long as you live.
Amen. So how is God involved in our daily life?
Every aspect of happens to us today or any day, if we give it to God, he will take care. He says, throw all those burdens to me. Don't keep them, because many times we weigh ourselves down because we try to figure out from a human standpoint. God already has a solution. We have to let go, and we have to let God. He says, give it to me. Give it to me. And he will take care of it, because he's already done what he's going to do.
Amen. So the Lord reveals himself. Oh, I'm sorry.
No, I was just going to add that because we are his creation, he sustains his creation. So that means he's going to watch over us, just like he looks out after the animals and all of the things that he created for us to enjoy, with us being the epitome of his creation because we were made in his image. So I love the scripture, the part of 121, where, you know, it says that he keeps us. And I love the part especially where it says he never slumbers or sleep. How many of us drop off in a chair and our hair's going like this? But he doesn't get tired. And right. I am so glad he doesn't.
Amen. Amen to that. So in our lesson, it tells us that the Lord reveals himself in scripture as the living God who acts on behalf of those who call upon him. For the psalmist, the Lord is always before me. Therefore, he trusts God and calls upon him. The Lord will hear even when he cries out in the depths, conveying that no life circumstance escapes God's sovereignty dominion. Thus, the psalmist's cry, no matter how urgent, is never devoid of hope. God is just so good in so many ways. And just looking at what was said in the clear word, too, we also understand how we can celebrate the power of the Creator in the faithful individual's life. And this power includes that he would not allow your foot to be moved. The image of the Lord is apparent as Israel's keeper who does not slumber. As Sister Finley was saying, it's her favorite part of that verse. Nor does he sleep. It highlights the Lord's constant alertness and readiness to act on behalf of his children. The Lord is your shade. It calls to mind the pillar of cloud in the time of the Exodus. The Lord provides physical and spiritual shelter to his people. God is at their right hand. It conveys God's nearness and favor. God shall preserve his children from all evil. He is always ready. So we should never feel despair or just ever doubt listening to the lies of the enemy that the Lord is not hearing, or we've done too much, that he won't do anything for us. The Lord is always ready. He's always ready to be in our life. We just have to call him and invite him and allow him. So the bottom line here, the psalmist trusted in God's loving care. We, of course, should do the same. Amen?
Amen.
Anyone else with any thoughts? Brother James?
I have a story to tell y'all. Our pastor was Pastor Ear Allen out of Chicago, Illinois. Her best friend, when she died, said she went into weeping and mourning for 40 days. Said she cried so much she had no more tears in her tear ducts. She yelled so much she had no more voice. After those 40 days, her Lord told her, open your Bible to the book of Joshua. She had my eyes on, Moses, my servant, is now dead. Rise up and cross over. And then turn to the book of Genesis. If I told I shall make of you a great name. So after that, she told God, I don't care nothing about a name. I don't have a leader anymore. I have no direction at all. See, little did she know what she had in store for.
Mm-hmm.
Pastor Allen's ministry lasted 25 years. Yours has lasted 50 years. Everything Pastor Allen has done, you have doubled everything and surpassed it. You are Elijah to her Elijah.
Okay.
Yes.
All right, anyone else? Any Sister Ledbetter?
One. 21 that Elder Finley read had to do with the Lord. He neither slumbers or sleeps. If anyone has worked a night shift and a 12-hour night shift, about 11 or 12 o'clock, your eyes get real heavy. But if you're a nurse in an ICU and you have a patient that's one-to-one, or I may have three or four patients in labor and one is about to deliver, I can't sleep. I have to be awake, and we have four stages of sleep, and in one of those stages, you literally, your vitals get so low that you can die in your sleep. So we're thankful that God is right there, no matter, and he doesn't get sleepy. I mean, when you work in a 12-hour shift, sometimes you got to walk around, do whatever you got to do to stay awake, because that patient's life is dependent upon your being alert and awake.
Yes, yes. And we thank God for people like you, Sister Ledbetter. We do know in the medical health care, everyone doesn't have that passion, but we thank God for people like you. Amen. Okay, anyone else? Okay, so let's, you, okay.
I'd just like to add our lessons talking about assurance of God's care. And the one thing we as humans fail to do, if we are assured of his care, then we need to learn how to trust him. And not trust in our own selves, but trust him.
Exactly.
And God has said over and over in the Bible, trust me, trust me, try me. And we just feel not, we feel to do that.
I know.
And that to me is, I have to surrender my all.
Right, right. Because if we're not listening to God, or obeying God, then we're setting up our own barriers. Amen? We're blocking God's blessing, as she said. You know, in order to cooperate with God, follow his will for your life. As simple as that. And let all your choices be choices that keep the channel of blessings open for you in your life. Amen? I have a friend that says all the time, I just do easy. I said, what is that? I just trust Jesus. Just do easy. It's the easiest way to go. Because we get in our own way. You know what I'm saying? Let's go over to Tuesday. The Lord is a refuge in adversity. So what does the psalmist do in times of trouble? There's so many scripture here in the lesson. We don't have time to read them all. I'm just counting on the fact that you have read them, or maybe you can look it up real quick. But what does the psalmist do in times of trouble? And to make it easier, can someone read Psalm 88, 1 through 4? Psalm 88, 1 through 4. That's a prayer for help in despondency, a psalm of the sons of Korah. They also were authors in the book of Psalms.
Psalm 88, verses 1 through 4. Mm-hmm. O Lord God of my salvation, I have cried day and night before thee. Let my prayers come before thee, incline thy ear unto my cry. My soul is full of trouble. My life draweth nigh unto the grave. I am counted with them that go down into the pit. And a man that has no strength.
So what does the psalmist do in times of trouble?
He cries out.
He cries out. He seeks the safety and protection from the Almighty God of heaven. Amen. Sister Finley, Elder Finley.
I just love this particular day of this lesson in terms of seeking refuge, because I love the imagery that they use about seeking shelter under the shadow and the wings of the Almighty. If you can just imagine a bird, like we had that little bird back there in the window, and we watched it each week, and the mother bird would fly back and forth. And so even though that nest was its shelter, the mother was truly sheltering them too, mm-hmm. because she was watching over them and protecting them. And when we seek refuge and shelter under the wings and solace of the Almighty, it's kind of like, okay, God, you're my landlord. You're going to protect me. You're going to be my bodyguard 24/7, 365. And so when we have adversity in our life, that's the first person we should run to.
Amen.
Is to run to him, because he has all the answers for us and he has safety and protection for us.
Amen. Amen. So we know that we are not alone in times of our worst needs. The Psalms is such a beautiful, I don't know if I can call it a book, a collection of songs and praise. We are not alone in our times of worst need. We have a Father who listens to us and welcomes us into his arms of protection. That is good news. God is present always, and he shows us in Scripture that not only does he understand our pain and suffering, but that he has a remedy for us in the great plan of salvation. It is through the great controversy that he guides us gently to the end of time, where all things will be made brand new for those who love him and have kept his commandments. It is him that we put our trust and maintain our faith instead of despair when evil presents itself and tries to discourage us. I see you. I realize that the injustices experienced in our lifetime are just another part of life that connects us to our Creator, who, when you really think about it, he has experienced the greatest injustice of all. His world is not perfect anymore. And he understands that sin has brought in so many tribulations to his creation, things that we should never have ever had to experience. So that is a great injustice to God. He doesn't like it, and he has a remedy. And he's going to one day show us his face and bring us back with him, where we'll share the same address once and for all one day. So when we're going through our tribulations, we have to realize that he is very well acquainted with our griefs, and he knows our discomfort. And what we have to do is seek his face, even like when I said sometimes things have gotten so bad, I didn't want to pray, but I did call out the name of Jesus. And that's all I needed to do, and I started to feel things turning around. But all we need to do is seek his face when we're under attack, just as the psalmist does. And I saw your hand, Sister Gilliam.
I think that whether we want to admit it or not, I think that in all of our lives, we wanted to run from an adversity because we were afraid. We didn't know how we were going to react to a certain situation, because I was listening to what you said, Elder Boone, and I thought of an experience that I had before I retired. And the last 5 years of my retirement, before I retired, they were the toughest 23 years that I had had at IUM. And I thought about a situation that happened in the office, and I became so angry about it. And I got my coat, and I started to walk out. And the Lord spoke to me and said, "Now, you say that you trust me. Now go back." And I told the Lord, "I'm not going back." You know, just like that. I said, "I'm not going back." And so I was going out the door, and something grabbed me in the back of my coat and said, "Go back." Mm-hmm. So I went back, and I apologized for something that I didn't even do. But my coworker told me this. She said, "I knew you would come back." And so a lot of times we have to recognize that the things that we go through, it's not only for us, but it's for somebody else.
Amen. Amen.
And so that stayed with me for a long time. And I got to thinking to myself, well, who do you think you are? You know, the Lord went through more for my salvation than I'll ever go through. Mm-hmm. And so we have to ask the Lord to give us a little humility and just ask him to hold it together for us. Mm-hmm. Because sometimes it's tough. It's really tough out here in this world. And it's going to become tougher. We're going to be met with more challenges. And if we can't pass the test with some of these small challenges now, when the ones that really hit us later on, we're not going to be able to pass the test.
Amen.
And so my prayer every day is, Lord, hold it together for me, because sometimes I can't do it. I can't do it at all.
Mm-hmm. I remember Pastor David saying some years ago, it's going to be little things that keep people out of heaven. So it should be each of our prayer. Lord, show me my sins, even those deep-seated secret sins, the ones you don't want to face. But we have to do that, because we don't want to miss out on that eternity. It's just going to be such a blessing. So that's good. That's good. Everything you said is true. So trying to move along a little quickly, can someone summarize Psalm 17:8 and Matthew 23:37? What image is used here, and what does it reveal about the Lord?
Well, they refer to the fact that, well, they use the imagery of the protection under the wings of, or in the shadow of, the Almighty. Again, back to the metaphor and the imagery of the bird of being under the wings. And so that's what it's basically talked about there. My mind comes to T. Marshall Kelly's song that he would always sing, "Under His Wings."
Amen. So the Lord is depicted as a powerful king ready to fight for his people. And at the same time, he is also represented as a kind and loving God who cares for his creation. I'm kind of running short on time. Let's move to Wednesday, Defender and Deliverer. Defender and Deliverer. And it has us to read 1 Corinthians 10, 1 through 4. And I will read that in your hearing. "Moreover, brethren, I do not want you to be unaware that all our fathers were under the cloud, all passed through the sea. All were baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea. All ate the same spiritual food, and all drank the same spiritual drink. For they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ." Okay, so how does the Exodus story creep up in here? I shouldn't say creep up. How is the Exodus story depicted in this scripture? Sister Gilliam.
Well,
God is true to his word. And God defended the Israelites in Egypt with the help of the angel of death. And he delivered them through the wilderness and crossing the dry sea.
Mm-hmm.
He defended his character by allowing his word to reveal truth in the risen Savior.
Okay, he's our Savior. That's right. It kind of entails everything they went through the Exodus experience, the cloud, the passing through the Red Sea. And the Red Sea, by the way, was correlated as being a baptism. So, and then it refers to the man and the water from the rock. And then emphasizes that it all came from Jesus Christ. All of that protective care, if any of you have doubted his care in your life, okay? I think you have done something so bad that he does not love you. I cannot think of anybody who was more stiff-necked than the Israelites. Like, they made me mad, you know, just reading about it. I always wanted to go back. Let's go back to Egypt anytime something didn't go the way they expected it to go. Okay, let's see here. Sister Finley, can I choose you again to read Psalms 114? I like it in the clear word.
You want me to read all 8 verses?
Yes, I can read half if you want. I think this is a very funny scripture. It's funny in a way, like not disrespectful, but it's just interesting how the Lord depicts his power and his care.
Okay, I'll read all 8. When Israel left Egypt and the descendants of Jacob left that foreign land, Judah became the Lord's ruling tribe and all of Israel his chosen possession. When the Red Sea saw them coming, it looked and ran away. Later, the Jordan River looked and stopped flowing. The mountains skipped like goats, and the hills jumped like lambs. Red Sea, what made you run from God's people? Jordan, what made you stop flowing? You mountains, why did you skip like goats? You hills, why did you jump like lambs? Tremble, O earth, the king is coming. Tremble and shake, the God of Jacob is approaching. Verse 8, he is the one who brings water out of the rocks and makes springs flow from solid cliffs.
Interesting how that's depicted there, but it just shows God as the creator with sovereignty over the powers of nature. The sea, the River Jordan, the mountains, the hills yield to him as he delivers the children of Israel from Egyptian bondage. This is metaphorically the salvation story of Jesus Christ. And it reminds me of another account in Matthew 8, 23 through 27, and where God commanded the sea and the storm to be still. It showed God's sovereignty. And I have run out of time, and I just thank you for all of your nuggets. And I will ask Sister Hampton if she will close us out from the Sabbath school service as we can begin our worship service. Thank you. Keep studying, saints.
See, I told you that was going to be an excellent study. I thank you all for participating. Just so many nuggets came out of this lesson. But as she said, we need to close for our next service. So would you stand for prayer, please? Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this excellent lesson study. We knew that you were omniscient, omnipresent, and I know there's a third one and I can't think of it. But, Lord, we know you're always there. We know you love us. And I ask you, Father, to be with us all today. Let this place be filled with the Holy Spirit. I ask you, Father, to allow the speaker of the day to hide himself in you and allow you, Lord, to speak through him. Thank you for this wonderful Sabbath day, Lord, and help us to keep it holy. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. Welcome you from the Mizpah Brunswick Church to those online. One of the first things we'd like to do this morning is we have some visitors here, and we'd like to welcome you. So would you stand? If not, we're going to call you out. Thank you. And Mizpah, how do we welcome our guest? Thank you. Please come back. You were a visitor this time. Next time, you will be family. Where are you gentlemen from?
Lake Station.
Praise the Lord. Thank you for worshiping with us this morning. You may be seated. Please remain seated after the benediction today, as offering will be collected by our deacons and ushers. For those of you young people who are on the church board, tomorrow you have a meeting at 10 a.m. The women of Mizpah, they usually have a breakfast, so they go to breakfast and fellowship. So we would like to see you on Friday, February the 2nd at 9:30 at Jetty's Restaurant on the corner of Ridge Road and Klein. We are also practicing now for our Black History Month program, so we please ask that you stay after for rehearsal today if you can. Also, this is from Sister Cheryl Hampton. Pray for her cousin, Pam Edmonds, Pat King's sister. She is in ICU in Indy after complications from surgery. So we know that when prayers go up, blessings come down, and we know that she needs that healing, so we ask for that. With special thanks, may the Lord reward you for all you have done, from Ruth 2nd chapter, verse 12. Your thoughtfulness has been a blessing. It accompanied us all the way, accompanied us all the way down to Louisville, Kentucky, is a time of sorrow. Lord, bless us to pass on your acts of kindness to the next person, love, Verdeen and Leander Gilliam. And they were going down that week for her brother's funeral, and she said it was a little bit icy and dicey. Now our January birthdays. This week, let's see, Brother Leander Gilliam was the 21st, Edward Britton was the 21st, Chelsea Flowers the 22nd, Jemina Heron is 23rd, Megan Barnett 24th, Adriana Lane the 24th, Pamela Hughes Smith the 26th, Sylvia Slack will be the 28th, which is tomorrow. Danielle Leon is the 29th, it's Monday. Donna Donneville is the 31st. And to all of our January birthday people, we want to say God praise you and thank you for another year, as we say, around the sun, because it is something. Life is short. And so there we have it. My thought for today is this. Don't worry. I've heard your cries. I can feel your pain. I have not forgotten you. I know that you may not understand all that I do, but I am always in control. I alone have all power. Out of your hurt and disappointments, I will bring you great joy. I need you to hold on during these difficult days ahead. Everything is going to be all right. Place your faith and trust in me like never before. Be still and know that I am God. Have a blessed and happy Sabbath. And if you were with us for Sabbath school, everything I said in there was right in the Sabbath school lesson. Be blessed. Thank you.
God, that we're all here. Our opening hymn is Jesus, Keep Me Near the Cross. I know that's all of our desire. We're thankful that He has made the sacrifice, and we are sure that He's going to keep us near the cross. Singing Jesus. standing.
Good morning. Happy Sabbath. And welcome to our family here in the sanctuary, as well as those of you who may be joining us online today. We are just so glad that you're able to be with us today for our Sabbath celebration of services here at the Mizpah Seventh-day Adventist Church in Gary, Indiana, where our pastor is Dr. Michael Horton, and our assistant pastor is Pastor Emmanuel Anderson. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Let's be glad because he's our Savior. Let's be glad because he's a mighty God and there is none other. Let's be glad because he loved us so much that he was willing to die that we may have eternal life through him at his second coming. Each week here at the Mizpah Church, we affirm our faith in Jesus Christ by reciting John 3:16 and 17. And I invite you to recite it with me at this time. If you have a bulletin, it is in there. And hopefully it will be on the screen, but it's John 3:16 and 17. Oh, it is on the screen. Let's recite it together. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Amen. Bow your heads, please, as we pray. Dear Father in heaven, we have come into this place today, and we've gathered in your name to worship you. To worship you with hymns of praise, with prayer, and thanksgiving. We thank you so much, O Lord, for another blessed Sabbath day, that you've carried us through another week. And so we come to rejoice in your holy presence. So Holy Spirit, come by and abide with us today as we worship the triune God in the beauty of holiness. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you.
Good morning, happy Sabbath. That's to everyone here and also to those of you who are watching online. Now we're going to just give a quick little story, and it's the Sabbath school lesson that the juniors did this morning. And I'm going to have a helper, Ryan Smith. Can you come up here? Okay. And we studied our lesson today. Normally we might show something on the screen, and so we get to see what the primary study, we get to see what the kindergarten study, but today we're gonna do what the junior study. Okay. So our title today was about worship, way to worship, and about praise and worship. Okay, and as we studied about Jesus going through the land with his disciples and going from town to town and worshiping with the people, having the people worship with him. And he would teach and preach. And his style of teaching and preaching was different than the Pharisees and the scribes. And the people could understand, because Jesus used examples. And Jesus also didn't act like he was high and mighty like the Pharisees and the scribes, okay? So, I'm gonna ask you a couple questions. It is easy to show that back in the day when God first instituted in the garden, he instituted a special day. What day was that? Oh, okay, let me let them. If you don't know, what day was that? What day are we here? What's the day? Okay, day is Saturday, okay? Okay, the seventh day. He instituted the seventh day. Okay, now, stand up here. Okay, so when he was here, he wanted us to come. What did we do today? Let's just think about what we did. We woke up this morning, we got dressed, we came here. And how do we start our Sabbath? What do we do first? We prayed, but what did we do? What service were we in? Like now we're in church. What service did we go to first? Here.
Sabbath school lesson?
Yeah, we did our Sabbath school lesson, okay? So, now when we came in here, these are ways to why we worship. First, why do we worship?
Because God created us in this day to meet with us as he did back in the garden with Adam and Eve.
And how many ways that you can give us for worshiping?
Sing hymns, studying our Bible, and Sabbath school lessons, giving our tithes and offering, praying, communion, hearing the word of God being preached by the pastor, assistant pastor, the elders, or guest speaker.
Okay, so we learned as young people that we are meant, God made us to do what? To praise and worship. And he loves, he meets us here. We just have to come out here and meet him. Okay? So to those of you online and to those of you who are here, I want to encourage you to keep coming out. Show up. And let's meet God. Amen. Can we pray? Can you do the prayer for me?
Amen. Heavenly Father, I just want to say thank you for today. And I want to say thank you for the nice weather that we're having this week, Father God. Lord, I just want to say thank you for all the people who came to church and people who are watching online. Bless us as we have a nice Sabbath day. In Jesus' name we pray, Christ, amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Trust in the Lord, I will trust in the offering appeal. This money says, in God we trust. It's not filthy lucre if it's properly used. Psalms 125th division, verse 1 says, those who trust in the Lord are like Mount Zion, which cannot be moved, but abides forever. So we thank God for this opportunity. It's offering time for the appeal, but you know, it's stewardship time, which includes our temple. What else? Our tithe, your time, and your talent. Your tithe is included in your treasure. I read in the scripture that everyone has a degree of faith, which is trust. And so all of the ways that everyone presents each week to you are a part of your trusting God. He has given you all. Give him your all. And so there's one more scripture I want to share with you before we pray about that, and that's the 37th division of Psalms. The third verse in this case says, trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and feed on his faithfulness, God's faithfulness. If man knows how to give you a reward for some work that you do, God gives you all kinds of reward. And sometimes we haven't done anything. So as Christians, whether it's your tithe and offering, Lord should not have to pry anything out of us. So I'm not going to give you a big spiel about what it's for. You already know. I just want you to sing with me one more time after I pray, and that is that you will trust in the Lord. Father, we bow before you to thank you for trusting us to trust you. We're sorry where we have not been faithful to all that we should have been faithful to, but we have changed. In 2024, we will be sure to do everything according to your blessings. And so as we return our tithes and offering, our time, our temple, our talents, everything to you, according to what you have given us, we thank you. We appreciate you. Help us to be more faithful in all that we do, and especially showing you how much we love you through our giving. In Jesus' name, amen. I will trust in going to hold you to that promise.
Song comes to my mind. What's that? Plenty good room. We got to fill some of these pews. But I want to thank the sisters and the elder who led us in worship. That was just beautiful. Every praise, every praise, every breath, every blessing. How fortunate we are. How fortunate we are. Lord help me. I'm just tired. So tired of being selfish. know, I'm praying to God, do this for me, do that for me. And man, I'm looking at folks in Gaza and folks right here and just all over the place who are really catching it. And I tell you, I'm not worthy the least of his blessings, but the Lord is faithful to us. And so we just give him thanks and praise. Well, at this time, we're going to have the installation of our officers. We ask all of our officers, if you've been elected to serve here at Gary Mizpah, we want you to come up to the front, our elders here, and whatever your department may be, if it's Sabbath school, if it's women's ministries, personal ministries, stewardship, whatsoever. Ask my wife to come in. Come up and stand with me, honey. She's an elder at the Emmanuel Church, and Lord knows she's been involved in the gospel probably longer than I have. But she became an Adventist. I shouldn't say that, but she's younger, so I'll fix that. I'll fix that right quick. Oh. What's that? Oh, my. I probably need to walk back to Chicago. I get some exercise. But the Lord, truly the Lord is good. Come on up. Come on up, Lord. I just want you to stand here with me.
Amen.
That's right. That's right. We just acknowledging how important family life is to us, right?
Amen.
But the Lord is good. And we're going to also ask all of you, if you are a member of Gary Mizpah, if you will stand also. And if, oh yeah. And we're going to ask lastly all of our brothers and sisters in the Lord, everybody can stand. Because we got something for everybody to do. Is that all right?
Amen.
All right. Let's pray. Loving God, our Father, we're just asking you to be here in a special way. We know that the prophets were anointed, the priests were anointed, the kings were anointed, even David was anointed 3 times. And Lord, we need to be anointed afresh today, every one of us. Whether we're pastor, associate pastor, elders, officers, members of Gary, or I shouldn't even say are simply Christian, because that's really the greatest thing that we can be, to be Christian, which is from the Greek word Christos, which means anointed people. That's what Christ is. He's the anointed one. And it's in his footsteps and in his power that we stand. So bless us now. In your name, amen.
Amen.
So, through the protocols of the SDA Church, the Seventh-day Adventist Church, the prayerful work of the nominating committee, and the vote of the members of Gary Mizpah, all of you who are standing here as officers have been placed in positions of leadership as church officers. We've come here by the vote of the executive committee. And you've come with me because the Lord ordained that, amen. But officers, your first responsibility is to God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. And the cultivation of the gift of faith. The Bible says God's given to every man, woman, and child the gift of faith. But we got to exercise it. So give him the preeminence that through the Holy Spirit, he may equip you as a member of the body of Christ and as a leader to do his will and his work. God working in you as you abide in him. Support the mission of Gary Mizpah with your time, your talents, your temple, and your treasury. Remembering that our service is the service of love, We're not doing it because we got to. Amen. We're doing it out of gratitude for the goodness of the Lord. Yes. So it's the service of love and appreciation for God's great gift, his greatest gift of his Son for our salvation, and Christ's gift of his life and righteousness. And so, officers, will you seek by God's grace? Notice how I say that, because I read somewhere a lady wrote, all our promises are ropes of sand. Amen. So we need something to undergird that. We need somebody to co-sign that. That's the Lord. So, officers, will you by God's grace seek to do this?
Yes.
All right, praise the Lord. Secondly, I'm charging you in a sense, and myself, to value your family, talking about your immediate family. Now, we're all a part of the family of God, and we're a family here at Mizpah. But as officers, value your family life and endeavor to be rooted and to help them to be rooted and grounded in Christ. Remember that you and all of us are called as disciples to the ministry of reconciliation in our homes, in the Gary community and neighborhoods, and wherever you are called. Will you accept this call, officers?
Yes.
By his grace and the power of his Spirit. Amen. And then, thirdly, will you endeavor to be informed and to understand the work of your department and to help others to understand it? In other words, to understand your mission. And will you not, in other words, do not be reluctant or hesitant to seek assistance and counsel from the elders, from the pastor, from the many resources that are available to us as members of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And so, will you also cultivate your faith through daily devotional time with Jesus in word and prayer? Notice that word, cultivate. Now, I'm not putting my wife on the spot again, but she's a cultivator. She always, every year, has a garden, flowers and vegetables and stuff, and she gets out there and makes me come out there. Had to get in that soil. You have to give it time. You know, if you let it go, you know what'll happen? All right, so we need to take this precious gift, cultivate our faith in devotional time with Jesus in his word and prayer, and be ready as disciples of Christ to give a reason to everyone that asks for the hope that is within us. Will you seek to do this, officers and members?
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord by his grace. Amen. And so, members of the Gary Mizpah Church, do you covenant by the grace of God to support your officers and departments and to seek to be involved in ministry to others? And I might even add, according to your gifts.
Amen.
Yeah, something. Don't ask me to do electrical work. I had to keep my insurance paid up for that, but that is not my gift or my talent. But will you covenant to do that by God's grace and to be involved in ministry to others, especially the community of Gary? Congregation, repeat after me. Yes, by God's grace, we will work in love and by faith to preach and live his gospel. Amen. At this time, Elder Turner is going to offer prayer and I will follow her.
Heavenly Father, once again, we've come to thank you, to thank you, to thank you. You are so wonderful. Not only did you make the heaven and earth and all of us and everything that is in it, you have called us to mission with you. We ask that as we will follow Christ's lead,
yes,
that you would touch each one of us, anoint us to do your work according to your will. And then when all is said and done, we ask that we would be among those that would be saved, live with you eternity, yes, see your face day by day.
Yes,
and
yes,
we praise you for this opportunity. Now we ask special blessings upon the Mizpah Brunswick Seventh-day Adventist Church.
Amen.
That we will continue to climb the high mountain. You have blessings for us that we want to claim this year that we missed last year. So we ask that as these blessings come forth, that all of us total membership involvement, that we would meet together, that we would work together, that Amen. We would pray together, Amen. That we would sing together, that we would praise together. And when all is said and done, we would be saved together. In the name of Jesus, we do pray. Amen.
Amen. Loving Father, we thank you for each of these officers, every department. Father, we thank you for our members. And particularly, Father, we thank you for our children. We thank you that there's a generation that's coming of children, of young people, oh God. And we pray that this will always be a space in which they feel welcome, cherished, and loved. And Lord, we remember your counsel that it's better for us to have a millstone tied around our neck and be cast into the depths of the sea than to cause one of these little ones to stumble. Oh Lord, use us, because we're living in a time and in a community that needs the counsel and wisdom that only God can give through elders to the younger people. Today, Father, we just pause in this dedication to remember our brother, Father, Brother Sheridan Smith, and give you praise for the impact that he's had upon young lives throughout Gary and beyond, throughout the four or five states of this conference, Father. We heard the testimonies yesterday from the young people themselves, oh God. And we want you to do even as you did for him, oh God. You've told us through your servant that there is no limit to the usefulness, the effectiveness, to what can be accomplished by one who's setting self aside consecrates themselves wholly to you. And so, Lord, today, this is what we're doing. Even me, even us, oh God. Let some of the drops of that powerful dew of the latter rain fall on us, Lord. And even in our time, let the outpouring come. Bless these officers. Anoint and ignite them with the love of your glory, oh God. Bless these members. And even our friends who are visiting today, God, that Christ will be glorified in our lives. We'll be careful to give you all the praise, honor, and glory, because we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Now, before you go to your seats, this is important enough, you know. Because like when they inaugurate the president, he has to, right? He say, you know, Oh, you all doing it, but I'm just saying he has to repeat his name, right? Let's say I, James Wilson, okay? And I'm not going to prophesy about who the next one will be, but, and that's why it's important for each of you, starting over here, to give us your name, your department. You're going to take just a moment to do that, if it's important enough to bring you down here, so everybody will know. So we're going to start over here.
Hi, Cheryl Hampton.
Oh, wait, hold on, we need to get a microphone. Thank you.
I, Cheryl Hampton, am the church clerk.
Yes, indeed.
I, Brenda Ledbetter, am health ministry leader as well as prison ministry leader.
All right.
I, Janice Hurley, is a head usher and a community service center leader.
Praise the Lord.
I, Marla Gibson, children's ministry leader.
I, Fred Reed Jr., elder and director of music.
Amen.
I, Bernine Gilliam, am the HR and policy and procedure coordinator.
All right.
I, Sandra Turner, first elder, Sabbath school superintendent.
Amen.
Pastor Emmanuel Anderson, I am the assistant pastor of the Mizpah Seventh-day Adventist Church. Amen.
Now wait a minute.
All right.
Pastor, before we go on, see, I shouldn't say this because this is being streamed, but we got to work on that assistant. That associate is what we, but we'll work on that.
Okay.
We'll work on that.
We'll say associate.
Yeah, because we, you know, assistants feel like they're kind of distant and uninvolved, but we're going to be tight. Okay.
I, Margaret Finley, an elder.
I, Lisa Boone,
Sabbath School Committee, and Fellowship of Elders.
Amen.
I, Lisa Pittman, is Family Life Leader.
I, John Barfield, Security Manager.
Amen.
I, Ernestine Johnson, I don't even know where to start. Women's Ministries, Sabbath School, Treasurer, Finance Committee, and whatever.
Amen. Whatever needs to be done.
I am Trinata Radcliffe, and I am the Assistant Youth Leader.
Praise the Lord.
Evelyn Thomas, Head Deaconess.
I, Darrell Armstrong, just a deacon.
Just a deacon. Praise the Lord. Thank you, everyone. And I think we got Brother Thomas up there, our media. Is he up there? There he is. Praise the Lord. And this is Ruthie, or Dr. Ruth Horton. Yes. All right. Praise the Lord. Okay, everybody can be seated. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Oh, you want a photo? Okay. Could everybody come back? They want to get a photo. Well, that's all right, camera. That's a wide angle lens. No? Okay.
Prayer time, church. When we leave today, no one will accuse us of not having prayed to our God. Amen. As we get into the attitude and the spirit of worshipful prayer, I just want to let you know that God has a sincere purpose for this church. As we are coming out of these hard times, losing a member of our church, I want you to know that his efforts were not in vain, and that this city, God has a plan for this city. And as we pray this morning, I want your hearts to be focused on the city of Gary, Indiana. As you get comfortable kneeling at whatever position you are comfortable in praying, if you want to come closer and have community, have a communal prayer, come on closer. If you have a special prayer that you want to bring on down to the altar, feel free to come on down. And we're praying. Father in heaven, Lord, we thank you so much for this day. We thank you for creating a gift for us out of time itself so that we could come together and have spiritual community together worshiping our God. Father, we know that we need you in these times. We see the earth in its condition getting worse and worse. We see people getting further and further away from you. And Lord, we don't know what else to do but call on the name of the Lord. And we're calling you this morning, Lord, because we, as we get installed in churches, Lord, as we have positions in churches, Lord, we're telling you we want to be used by you, Lord. We're giving you our all, our talent, our treasury, our time. Lord, we're giving you our all. and we want you to use it for this church, Lord. We want your spirit to change us. We want your spirit to change this city. We want your spirit to change our children. We want your spirit to bring that school back. We still believe in Christian education, Father. The greatest evangelism we could do is with the children, Father. So we thank you for Sabbath school. Because when I was in Sabbath school, I remembered those lessons. Maybe not immediately, but I remembered them when I needed to remember them. And Father, thank you so much for growing up in church, Lord. For people who prayed for me, who intercessory prayed for me week after week while I was acting a fool, leaving church, coming back. They did not give up on me. And look at what you did, Father. Look at what you have done. Look at what you are doing. If you can save a wretch like me, I know what you can do for this city, Lord. As we end the first month on the last Sabbath, all the officers have been installed. The pastors are here, Lord, and we're ready to work. We are ready to work for your kingdom, Father, because what we understand, so clearly is that in working for you, we are working out our own salvation with fear and with trembling. Father, I pray that your spirit will be given to us 100-fold, 1,000-fold. Give us what we need. Give us the prayers to ask when we don't even know what to pray, Father. You know the blessing that we stand in need of, Lord. We need healing, Father. Some of us are struggling, and we need a touch from you. For our sick and shut-in members, we need you to go into their home and tell them we need you back here in these four walls. We need your spirit to bring the people here, because we are blessed when we are together, when we are united, when we are focused on you. And Father, that is our prayer for the rest of these 11 months, Lord. May our focus not be diverted from the cross, Jesus and him crucified. And if we should slip, Father, we pray that we will not allow the devil guilt us into staying down. We get up. Yes, we fall down, but we will get up. We will fight for God every day. And I pray the prayer in faith that every person under the sound of my voice will be saved in your kingdom, Lord. Father, I remember when the man prayed over me. He said he prophesied over me and said, that's a preacher right there. Well, I'm going to prophesy this morning. We're going to take this city for Jesus Christ. Gary, Indiana is yours, Father. And we pray that you will give us the power to go and receive the city. We pray this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Thomas, he helped me so much. I'm trying to get my PowerPoint together, and thank you, Bishop. And again, I want to just thank our musician and our singers. Praise the Lord. Down in St. Louis, they would say the singers. They sang. They blessed the Lord. And just all of you who are here. As I begin, who was here for Wednesday prayer meeting? I want you to stand. If you would stand, if you were here for prayer meeting, what was it, 12 o'clock Wednesday? Okay. Got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And I got, yes, sir, help us out. And I don't know who's going to get this one, Charles Bradford Sabbath Roots. I was thinking about Brother Gilliam, but I mean, I shouldn't be patriarchal. One of the sisters can have that. He was here. Oh, yeah, he was here. But I'm saying that doesn't necessarily mean he should get Elder Brooks, Sabbath Roots. But I'm saying one of the sisters might want it. So I'll just leave it however Pastor distributes them. And that's just a thank you for the privilege of being with you for prayer meeting as they kept the prayer watch for Gary Mizpah, for Gary, Indiana, and even for the issues of the world, believing that prayer, by prayer we mean calling on the name of Jesus, calling on the Lord, Jehovah, Yahweh, whichever, you know, of his names you like. We believe it makes a difference. Amen? We believe it makes a difference. And so there we are. But let's get into our message today. And we're going to pray that things go well with the technology. If it's on, okay. Man, I sure appreciate you now. Because I see it's not on, but I'm trying to figure out what do I push to get it on. On the side. Oh, there it is.
There you go.
Oh, the light is green.
Navigating those.
Okay. Ooh. All right, praise the Lord. All right. We're going to pray in just a second. But first I want to say there's a statement. Well, let me begin by saying this. In the Bible, there are some short names and statements that are called super caps. Super caps. You'll see everything in capital letters. And so let's turn to Jeremiah chapter 23. And we're going to see an example of that. And we want to look at Jeremiah chapter 23, verses 5 and 6. And we're going to ask everybody to stand, get a little blood circulating just a little bit, once more, as we honor the word of God. And the scripture says, Jeremiah 23, 25, and 6, "Behold, the days come, saith the Lord." And I'm going to emphasize, I don't need to say it over and over and over again, but I'm going to emphasize wherever we see Lord, capital L, capital O-R-D, this is the Hebrew tetragrammaton, the four letters, yod, hey, vav, hey, that is transliterated Yahweh. It's also transliterated Jehovah. But we need to bear that in mind because it does not necessarily mean the same thing as Lord when someone is lording over someone. But it's a way of identifying the great I am that I am, because that concept is vital to understanding scripture. Can I get an amen? The great I am. I want to see. Okay. So, "Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will raise unto David," talking about a king, talking about his lineage, "a righteous branch, and a king shall reign," right? "And prosper, and shall execute judgment and justice in the earth." This is what we are yearning for. I said so many times, Handel got it right in the Hallelujah chorus, "and he shall reign forever." That is the great hope, to be through with elections and earthly coronations and all the things that we do on this earth with these inadequate and defective governments, because we are inadequate and defective human beings without the Lord. But there's this promise here. And verse 6, "In his days, Judah shall be saved and Israel shall dwell safely." And we understand Israel. See, we can read with the literal eye, but we need to read with the spiritual eye. To understand who and what Israel is, we have to go back to where we first encounter Israel. Jacob wrestled with the angel, with the messenger, with Christ. And his name was changed. We all are wrestling, have wrestled with sin. And we found a refuge in Christ. And our name has been changed, hopefully. The Lord will one day let you know what your new name is, give you a stone with that name. So when we read Israel, we know that the one who was the supplanter and the thief, Jacob, has now become one who has prevailed with God. He's been victorious. How? By acknowledging his need, his sinfulness, his wretchedness. And that's where our victory is. "Blessed are they that hunger and thirst for righteousness." So in his days, verse 6, "Judah shall be saved, Israel shall dwell safely. And this is his name whereby he shall be called. So now we encounter the super caps. I forget how many of them there are in the Bible, but they're so significant. The Lord, our righteousness, Jehovah Titzkenu, or Yahweh Titzkenu, the Lord, our righteousness. This is what we're going to study today. So just remain standing as we pray. Loving God, our Father, I bow before you in honor of your word, in honor of the blood that was shed, O God, that we might be able to receive your word that is quickening, it's life-giving, spiritual life, O God. Today, as we study Christ, the Messiah, Yahshua, Jesus, our righteousness, may we be quickened in the inner man, woman, and child, that we can be clothed with your righteousness, our wretchedness taken away. And we'll give you all the praise, honor, and glory because we ask it in your matchless name. Amen and amen. You may be seated. Thank you. Christ, our righteousness. Man, that's what the word of God is all about. How do you take wretched human beings like me, like us, and conform us to the image of his son? In Romans chapter 8, we read, and we claim this promise all the time. It says in Romans chapter 8, I can't remember the exact verse, but it's there. It says, and we know that God works all things together for good to them that love him and are the called according to his purpose. And we stop there. Now, first, I must commend us because you all have the profession of faith, Romans 3:16, and you didn't stop there, did you? Because Romans 17 brings more light on it. God didn't send his son in the world to condemn the world, but the world through him might be saved. And that's the same thing we need to do with that verse. God works all things together for good to them that love him and the called according to his purpose, for whom he did foreknow, he did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his son. That is God's purpose. We kind of read it as a general, you know, general thing. Well, he's working it all together for good. The good is that we be conformed to the image of his son, Christ's likeness. And Lord, we live in a world where there's a lack of Christ's likeness. In fact, people, we've come to a place where people celebrate. Oh, my goodness, Lord, I don't want to say it, but the Spirit is leading me there. Even many Christians celebrate unchristlike character in people. Think about my Lord being persecuted, never said a mumbling word. Dignity, poise in the midst of persecution because he knew who he was, and God wants us to know whose we are. The message of Christ, our righteousness, which is a message from the Old Testament, a message from the Torah, is fresh all the way through the Bible. Because as the spiritual said, none but the righteous shall see God. And yet in Romans it said, there's none righteous, no, not one, but the Lord, justifying us freely by his grace, clothing us with his righteousness, washing us by his blood. Scripture tells us without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sin. Blood is so precious that Abel was slain by his brother Cain. And the scripture tells us his blood yet speaks today. That's how precious life is to God. And now think about all the lives that have been slain, have been murdered, and the blood that has been shed that is crying out to God today. God hasn't forgotten any of it. And we need to, as Christians, we need to understand our role in bringing the confusion of this world, the controversy of this world, to a close so that the true messianic era of Christ, the kingdom of God that he taught about,
the Sermon on the Mount, his life, that this can become a full reality. Why do I say full reality? Because if you know the Lord, if you truly know him, you have tasted the power of the world to come. You've already tasted it. Oh, yeah. Jesus said, the kingdom of God is within you. If Christ is abiding there. So let me. Yom Kippur. Last week, I talked about this. The foundation of the Advent faith. The great movement that took place before 1844. After 1798, the close of the 1260 days. That's a prophecy that occurs in the Bible in seven places. Sometimes it's 1260 days. Sometimes it's 42 months. Sometimes it's called time, times, and the dividing of times. A time is 360 days. So two times is 720. And the dividing is the 180. And it adds up to 1260 also. These are the tools that we need in our toolbox to really understand prophecy and to share it with the world. When you can show them conclusively that the 1260 days that began in 538 ended in 1798, that history confirms prophecy, scholars at Oxford, at Harvard, at Yale, Cambridge, Berkeley, wherever, will tell you. 1798, and at the Gregorian Institute at the Vatican, 1798, Napoleon was trying to conquer Europe. He wanted to unite Europe again, as it was in the Roman Empire, and that's been the history of Europe. And he sent his general to kidnap the Pope, General Berthier. You can just look it up. You can Google it. And he arrested him and imprisoned him. And the power of the Holy Roman Empire was broken. That's what it writes about in the prophecy. It said that this power would suffer a deadly wound. But then it says that the wound would be healed. When was it healed? When Mussolini signed a concordat with the Vatican in the 1920s. So 1798, we're now entering into the time of the end. Great awakenings are happening in the United States. 1834 began to preach this message because what we're coming up to 1844, which is the end of this long time period, 2,300 days, and 2,300 days in prophecy is how long? 2,300 years. That's right, day for year. It's in Numbers, it's in Ezekiel. So that began, as I told you last week, it's been 180 years since 1888 that we've been living in the time of judgment, the antitypical Day of Atonement, when heaven is seeking to wrap up this work of the gospel to the world so that the kingdom, so that the king can come and reign. Thank you, Brother James, right? Yes, that's right, because he's not just coming to be here, he's coming to reign. Oh my goodness, and man, you're starting stuff, see? Because he's not just coming to reign, but he has told the church of Laodicea that those that overcome, he will grant to sit with him on his throne as he overcame and sits on his Father's throne. So he said unto me, unto 2,300 days, then shall the sanctuary be cleansed. That's Daniel 8:13. After the great disappointment, after the time period came, it was fulfilled. They thought it meant that Christ was returning to the earth. They discovered he didn't come. And so they said, what does this mean? But they knew from the fruits of the experience that the Holy Spirit was leading them. Because people's lives were changed, they were transformed, they were brought closer to the Lord, they were made more loving, people confessed their faults one to another, humbled themselves. I mean, they were serious. And so they continued to search the scriptures. And lo and behold, you know what they found out? In Revelation chapter 10, they found the answer. The Lord had prophesied the great disappointment. that there would be an error, there would be a mistake. But afterwards, and it's all in Revelation 10, don't have time to go into it right now, but afterwards they were told, you must prophesy again before many peoples, nations, tongues, and kings. And that's where we are today. This is what we are doing. We must give the trumpet a certain sound. We know what the shofar was in the Hebrew culture. It was the ram's horn. And it was used to call the people together for assembly. It was used to warn. There was time, a danger was approaching, or war was coming. It was used to announce the festivals, the feasts, the moeds, the times of the Lord. And so it had tremendous significance. And, you know, it really went back to the experience. God is awesome. It went back to the experience of Abraham when he took Isaac, his son. And he felt he knew Jehovah. And he said, this is Jehovah's voice that's telling me to offer my son. He said, I don't understand it. He said, but I've been walking with him and he's been with me. He said, and I'm going to offer him. And his son Isaac, they went up on Mount Moriah. And up there, as he's about to offer his son, leaving it in the hands of the Lord, trusting, only trust him. Didn't they sing that song? Jehovah Jireh. He looks in the bush, in the thicket, and there is the ram, the ram's horn, the power of God to deliver. And that horn, that ram's horn, the power and symbol of that, because it really pointed to, as Abraham said, God will provide the offering, the lamb, and God provided his son, didn't he? He provided his son, who is the only true sacrifice that mattered, foreshadowed by all the other sacrifices. And so because of this, he desires you, every one of you here, and many who don't know, to understand that you are his chosen people in Christ. As you believe on him, if you are Christ, the scripture says, you see, God has this way of repetition and enlargement. What began with Abraham, but the covenant said that in Abraham, all nations of the earth would be blessed. And then Paul expounds upon it, the great Pharisee, the great scholar, everything that he was, converted. He says, if you are Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and you're an heir according to the promise. So he desires his chosen people to value ourselves according to the price he has placed upon us. The priceless gift of the Lamb. I have just a few points, if I can stay focused here. Thank you. Lord willing, I will get to preach here again. Lord willing. Yeah, Lord willing. But one big point I want to remember, God has taken the initiative. God took the initiative. Have you ever had a falling out with somebody? And folks say, I'm not going to get in touch with them. I ain't going to be bothered with them. If they want to straighten things, then they need to come. Right? That's how we do. But think about it. The Lord was the aggrieved party, but he took the initiative. He came looking for Adam and Eve, and they already went to their ducking and dodging, you know, as we do as human beings. Folks still doing it. You can't get them into the church. Folks still ducking and dodging. I did it for a while in my life. And tried everything else. I said, there's only one place you can find peace and security. Let me emphasize it. It's in the Lord. And once you're in him, there's no place else to go but to the people of God, to the church. And so anyway, I got to keep pressing on. So Jesus, Yeshua, is the Savior of the world. We emphasize this because, again, this shows the initiative of the Lord. When Adam and Eve sinned, that should have been the end of everything. Like, you know, blot this planet out. You know, let's do another thing, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But the grace of God unto salvation was extended to them. The Lord had laid on him as the lamb slain from the foundation of the world, the iniquity of the world. The God who is in eternity could cover the past, the present, and the future by the sacrifice of Christ, by the promise of the sacrifice. Effective there in the garden to save them. And the eternal God comes into history through a woman. Folks say Eve caused the problem. That's all right. The Lord used a woman. He said, okay, let me show you what can be done through a woman. He said, I'm going to send you salvation. No brother, no earthly brother helped. He said, a virgin shall conceive. I know. And then the Lord showed you what he could do with a man, didn't he? Because he took this man, Joseph, who was saying, man, you know, I love Mary. Man, I'm going to have to put her away. What has she done now? She done fallen off. And the Lord, you know, the Lord said, look here, Joseph. And we know the story. But the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Then it says, he is the propitiation for our sins. And not for our sins only, but for the sins of the whole world. The propitiation, the word in Greek is hilasmos or hilasterion, which means, it means the same thing as the mercy seat. He's the one who makes the mercy seat effective. That's the Ark of the Covenant. On the Day of Atonement, the blood went on the top of the ark. And propitiation was made. Reconciliation was made. Christ, the blood of Christ has done that. Oh, so, as Ellen White writes, and of course we believe in the gift of prophecy. The Bible's replete with prophets who never wrote a book in the Bible, but they were used of God to bring counsel to God's people according to the word of God. Gospel works 3:15, I present before you the great grand monument of mercy, the mercy seat, and regeneration, new life, salvation and redemption. The Son of God uplifted on the cross. This is to be the foundation of every discourse given by our ministers. The Apostle Paul, he just exemplified this. He said, I count myself to know nothing among you but Jesus Christ and him crucified. Or another way of putting that, he's saying, I don't care how much you know. If you don't know Christ and him crucified, you don't know nothing. You're just an educated fool. We're making it plain. Isaiah writes about it. He says, the ox and the ass know their master. But he talked to Israel, he said, and you don't know your creator, Lord, help us. And it's amazing that the same time that these closing judgment hour messages were coming to the earth, that would go to every nation, kindred, tongue, and people, that would make the roots of the Hebrew Torah open to the world, and it's rooted in the creation. That's the first thing we see about creation. At that same time, so many false doctrines. Thank you. James, you and I are going to get along real good. I mean, it's around this time, shortly thereafter, that the origin of species, Darwin and evolution, and so many just counterfeit, corrupt, godless theories began to come into being. At the core of this is agape. God so loved the world, agape. Now, I don't want to get off on a tangent, but you know, when we were coming up, some of y'all might be my age. You're a little bit younger. You're a little bit younger. I can look at you and tell. But we love that music, Motown. all singing about love. And Lord help you if that's the only counsel and insight you got into what love was. Woo! Because they were all talking about love as a feeling. No, brothers and sisters. Love is a high and holy principle. And it's this word agape that was saved from the other words that were used for love in the Greek. Saved because it took the love of God to embody it. This selfless love. Now, let me tell you something about agape. We may not even finish this message today, but that's all right. Agape love is so deep. Because we are so self-centered. Maybe I should just say myself. I'm so self-centered. I think about me and mine. And Lord, if you can just save me. And I just want to make it in. We got all those kind of things, right? We just shortchanging the grace of God. But I want to tell you about the two brothers. And I'm sure there was a sister also. I can think of one. Who graduated. Not cum laude. Not magna cum laude. But summa cum laude. The first brother was named Moses. Oh yeah, his name was Moses. And you know, Israel had rebelled. They had built the golden calf. And you know, Moses left he up in the mountains with Jehovah. And Aaron down on earth. And Aaron became political. You know, he said, got to give the people what they want. They try to keep things in order. Go on, build the calf. You know, bring your ring. We're going to build the calf. They built the calf. Golden calf. Reminds me, that there's a golden bull down there in Battery Park in New York City. People still worship the calf. It's down there in the finance district to remind people about the, reminds me anyway, when I see, of the love of mammon. But anyway, so when Moses comes back, come on, brother, angry. Talk to me. And the Lord is kind of, I believe the Lord was testing Moses. Moses, I'm going to get rid of these people. And I'm going to take you and I'm going to make a new nation. We're going to start with a whole new lineage. We're going to get rid of this nonsense. And Moses said, let's read it from the Word of God. Moses in Exodus chapter 32. Exodus chapter 32, where is this? 32. Here it is. Exodus 32, beginning of verse 30. And it came to pass on the morrow, on the next day, that Moses said unto the people, you have sinned a great sin, and now I will go up unto the Lord. Peradventure, I shall make an atonement for your sin. And Moses returned unto the Lord, and he said, oh, this people have sinned a great sin and have made them gods of gold. Yet now, if you will forgive their sin, there's a dash. In other words, if you forgive their sin, well and good, that would be great. And if not, Moses says, blot me, I pray you, out of their book, which you have written. Moses, in other words, is saying there's something more important than my salvation, Lord. He said, this nation that you have raised up called Israel is to glorify you in all the earth and to complete the covenant promises made through Abraham, Lord. And it's your glory. It's your glory that's at stake. And Lord, if you can't deliver them, if you can't work it out, Lord, just blot, if you have to destroy them, blot my name out of the book. He was partaking of the spirit of Christ, the Messiah, who was willing to lay down his life for the joy that was before him, that I might be saved, that you, that all of us might see his face. That's the first summa cum laude. And the other one's the Apostle Paul, Romans chapter 8. Or maybe it's not, Romans 9. Oh, the Apostle Paul. Man, what a guy. Got to see him when we get to glory. After that mountaintop, Romans chapter 8. Isn't that a mountaintop? What shall separate us from the love of God? Shall tribulation, famine, persecution, this, that, and the other? Nothing. We're more than conquerors through Christ. All that, you know, we rejoice in our suffering. Romans 8 is so deep. There's therefore no condemnation to them that are in Christ Jesus. Read Romans 8 when you want to be encouraged, when you want to be liberated, when you want to run down the aisle. Say, thank you, Jesus. Romans chapter 8. But then we come to 9. He says, I say the truth in Christ. I lie not. That's kind of Hebrew, isn't it? Say something twice, two different ways. I'm telling you the truth. I'm not lying. My conscience also bears witness with me in the Holy Ghost. That's a reference to chapter 8. He said, the Spirit will bear witness with our spirit. That's what happens for the Christian. The Spirit bears witness with us. He says, I have great heaviness and continual sorrow in my heart. He's got a burden. Why? Verse 3, he said, for I could wish that myself were accursed from Christ for my brethren, my kinsmen, according to the flesh. He says to be accursed, to be cut off from God. He said, I could wish I were cut off from God. Say, why, Paul? Because of my brethren who are Israelites, to whom pertains the adoption and the glory and the covenants and the giving of the law, day of Pentecost, and the service of God and the promises. He's talking about all that's been given to the Hebrews, to the Israelites, the patriarchs, the fathers, and of whom, as concerning the flesh, Christ came through that lineage. They have all this. Verse 6, not as though the word of God has taken none effect, for they are not all Israel which are of Israel. In other words, you're really only a part of Israel. You can't become a part of Israel by your natural physical birth alone. You're a cultural Israelite then. But you must be born again. Because we all, no matter who your parent is, we all are born in sin, shaping in iniquity. We're born and need to be born again. And this is what they didn't understand. Verse 7, neither because they are the seed of Abraham are they all children, but in Isaac shall thy seed be called. Why Isaac? In Isaac, the child of promise. And that's how we're born. And so Paul says, you know, it would have been good. We'd be all right, Lord, if you just cut me off so that they could be saved. All right. So let me go back to this. The lost sheep. This is, again, God's initiative. This is one thing I really want to emphasize. The lost coin, the lost sheep, the prodigal son. The scripture says that Christ came to seek and to save that which was lost, has taken the initiative in the parable of the lost sheep. Christ teaches that salvation does not come through our seeking after God, but through God seeking after us. Our seeking after him is our response to his seeking us. He says, he said, we can't even come except he draws us. And he's been drawing us through even the heavens declaring his glory and all the creation speaking of him. We do not repent, in other words, in order that God may love us, but he reveals his love to us in order that we may repent. So God took the initiative. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Jesus is the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. While we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son. And all of this is pointing again to the love of God. Whew, I don't know. I don't want to single out John. It's not my place to say it, but I will dare to speculate that perhaps no one writes of love the way the Apostle John the Beloved. Ooh. He emphasized, for God so loved the world. John chapter, 1 John chapter 3. Behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us that we should be called the sons and daughters of God. Beloved, now, right here now today, are we the sons and daughters of God. And I'm so glad he also wrote, it does not yet appear what we shall be. We look at each other, we say, you're a child of God. No, the Lord is still engaged in his work in us, if you will, brothers and sisters. But we know, yes, sir, but we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him. This is what the great salvific project is about. Recreating us in the image of God, restoring the image of God, which E.G. White says was well nigh obliterated. Almost obliterated, but it took the grace of God, the creative power of God to restore it. And so, brother or sister, sometimes we get discouraged. I feel like Dr. King sometimes. He said, I get discouraged sometimes. Sometimes I feel discouraged and feel my works in vain. But then the Holy Spirit revives my soul again. Come on, say amen. He says, desponding soul, take courage, even though you have done wickedly. Do not think that perhaps God will pardon your transgressions and permit you to come into his presence. God has made the first advance. While we were in rebellion against him, he went forth to seek us. Praise the Lord. And this is why Apostle Paul says, other foundation can no man lay than that which is laid. He said, God forbid that I should glory save in the cross of Christ, by which I'm crucified to the world. The power of the world is broken and the world unto me. And so the sacrifice of Christ as the atonement for sin is the great truth around which all other truths cluster. You know, when you came into the tabernacle, to the sanctuary courts, brothers and sisters, you came through the gates. You had to come with an offering. But the Lord has provided the offering. Had to go to the altar of sacrifice so that the lamb could be slain. The Lord has slain the lamb. Amen. And that's what makes it possible for us to go on to the laver and then to the holy place and on to the most holy place. It's the great sacrifice. And this is the most important project that's going on in the universe right now. All kind of projects going on. President Biden rebuilding infrastructure and other candidates want to make America great again. But, you know, I know somebody who's got a kingdom that's coming that will last forever. Where there'll be peace and no more death and no more war, no more destruction, no more violence, no more gunshot. And I'm sorry, I heard one of my sisters here, I forget her name, the OBGYN nurse. There she is back there. You will not have to work anymore. I know it. You've been faithful over a few things. The Lord gonna bring you up higher so you can testify about how he was using you. But that's the good news. So the sacrifice of Christ for the atonement of sin is the truth around which all other truths cluster. In order to be rightly understood and appreciated, every truth in the Word of God from Genesis to Revelation must be studied in the light that streams from Calvary. Figure out what I did now. I may have turned it off. I hope not. Green light. Okay, green light. Oh my, it's not going forward. Maybe I'm not pointing the right place. Let's try that. Okay. Yeah, thank you. The scripture says, 2 Timothy 1:10, Christ has abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. In other words, the gospel gives us life. The life that we have now here in this world is the purchase of the cross of Christ, the gospel, and eternal life also. All human beings are partaking of the first part of it. And when they hear the gospel preached, when they hear the good news, the prayer is that they will then partake of the So, in every page, whether history or precept or prophecy, the Old Testament scriptures are irradiated with the glory of the Son of God. Take time, some time to read the Old Testament scripture. All over the place you see the Messiah. So far as it was a divine institution, the entire system of Judaism is a compacted prophecy of the gospel. Hebrews chapter 4, Paul tells us the gospel was preached unto them in the Torah, in the prophets, in the Psalms. The good news is all there. It was a compacted prophecy of the gospel, and to Christ give all the prophets witness, brothers and sisters. Again, Christ has abolished death and brought life and immortality to light. In every sacrifice, Christ's death was shown. In every cloud of incense, his righteousness ascended. And he pointed to his ministry as our high priest. By every jubilee trumpet, his name sounded. And the jubilee points us forward finally to the second coming, brothers and sisters. In the awful mystery of the Holy of Holies, his glory dwelt. In the sanctuary, the scripture says God's way is in the sanctuary. He is the way, the truth, and the life, brothers and sisters. The tabernacle in the wilderness, God told Israel, let them build me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them. Getting close to the end. This is a good place to stop. You know, I drive up through some of the northern parts of Chicago and say, man, it's some nice place to live up there. I know Michael Jordan used to have, I mean, people got some palatial estates and everything. But this is the promise that we're going to dwell with God. And you know, the thing is, it doesn't excite people that much. That's interesting. I remember when I was a little fella, I got this bad habit of sharing my personal testimonies in grade school. There was a little girl that I liked. She lived nearby. And I remember whenever I would walk on that street where she lived, even if I didn't see her, I'd say, this is where such and such lived. You know, on the street where you live. Somebody wrote a song about that. Yeah, I've often walked down this street before, but the pavement always stayed beneath my feet before. Yeah. Anyway, but think about it. The tabernacle of God will be with man, and he will be with us and be our God. We shall be his people. Man, I remember when we were kids, we would go next door and borrow something from the neighbor, a cup of sugar, this, that, and the other. People not like that anymore. I need 3 eggs to do a cake. But we were good neighbors. But when we go to, I mean, the Lord, when we live in his neighborhood, we just say, Lord, I just wanted to drop by and just be in your presence. But this is, oh, Lord, this is so special. Okay, so I always got to share some books. Exodus and Advent movements. Study of the wilderness experience, comparing it to the Advent experience now. Okay, by Taylor Bunch. Many of you have it. Another book, Sanctuary, Path to the Throne of God, to help us understand the work of the sanctuary and what it reveals about the gospel, whether it's the tabernacle in the wilderness, as you see down below, or Solomon's temple up above, something that we need to understand, brothers and sisters. In fact, we're told that the correct understanding of the ministration in the heavenly sanctuary is the foundation of the Advent faith, brothers and sisters. And these are some of the names by which the temple is called: thy dwelling place, the palace, his holy temple, temple of God, the habitation of holiness. All of these, the tabernacle reveals the nature of Christ and the work of Christ. What I mean, the tabernacle reveals the nature of Christ. See those skins over the tent? Badger skins. I mean, they look nice, you know. Leather is an attractive, you know. It looks nice, nice leather purse, nice leather shoes, nice leather jacket, whatever. But it doesn't really capture the glory of God, because this represents the humanity of Christ. But the inner walls are gold. That represents the divinity. And we see the union of humanity and divinity revealed in the tabernacle. And that's why the sanctuary tells the greatest story ever told. The Cross and Its Shadow, that's the last book I'm going to share with you today. Stephen Haskell. Many of you have all these books, 3 of them, but they are easy reading. They're extremely insightful and instructive. All right, creation and salvation are one. That's why we're Sabbath keepers. The God who created in 7 days and ended his work and rested and hallowed the Sabbath is the same God who redeems and tells his people, hallow, keep holy my Sabbath. It'll be a sign between me and you that I am the Lord who sanctifies you, that you may know that I am the Lord. And then in Isaiah, it says from what? One Sabbath to another, one new moon to another, in the new heaven and new earth, all flesh will come to worship before him. All right, this is our last slide. We'll put that down to make sure, okay. This is what we have to be grateful for. This high calling that has been given to us, brothers and sisters, children of God, all a part of the family of God. The scripture tells us he made of one blood all nations to dwell on the face of the earth. And I will never forget this. When I was in the hospital, some serious surgery, man, I saw an international team of surgeons taking care of me. I didn't complain. I was grateful. Some were Jewish. Some were Islamic in their backgrounds. Some from Africa, some from India, some from the South and so forth. But they had one mission: to save lives. That's my man, Brother James. And brothers and sisters, that should be our mission. We don't want people perishing. You know, who? Mercy, mercy. Heaven will not be what it can be if I'm there and I just come through the gate. Oh, I made it in. And I can't look around and see anybody else whose life I've touched with the gospel of Christ. The invitation is simple. He says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden. He said, I will give you rest. He said, O earth, 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 hear the word of the Lord. He said, I will overturn, 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 talking about the kingdoms of this world until he come whose it is, which is Christ. Because the earth is the Lord's, the fullness thereof. Not human beings. I don't care how much folk divide it up and allocate empires and colonies and all these other things and financial companies divide up the world. The earth is the Lord's. It belongs to Jehovah, belongs to Yahweh, and the fullness thereof. And when this has passed, the madness of this age, we will enjoy peace like a river. Peace like a river. And we want to be there. We want loved one, friends, even the neighbors you can't stand. We want them to be there. Just ask, Lord, for the grace to love them and to represent Christ before them. You're going to shed some tears if you haven't already. Tears for loved ones, tears for friends, tears for people that you just want to know the Lord and the joy of his salvation. Today, I'm going to invite you to join me as I pray in closing, if you'll stand. I don't know what burdens or cares you may have on your heart today. The times we're living in, sometimes it seems that wickedness is prevailing. But the Lord has said through his prophets, when the enemy comes in like a flood, he will lift up a standard against him. That standard is the cross of Christ. Father, we want to know you and the power of your resurrection, that we can truly walk in newness of life now. We can experience your great agape love. Romans 5:5 tells us, as we believe on Christ, Romans 5:1, therefore being justified by faith in Yeshua, we have peace with God. And Romans 5:5 says, and the love of God, the agape of God, is poured abroad into our hearts, into our being, through the Holy Spirit that is given unto us. Lord, we ask for your Holy Spirit. We ask for your anointing. We ask for the presence of the Spirit of Christ, the Spirit of holiness, because we know it's not by might nor by power, but it's by your Spirit that your kingdom moves forward. It's by your Spirit that hearts are drawn to you, Lord. And we need your Spirit. It's the Spirit that bears witness with our spirit, telling others that we are children of God, so that it's not just us talking, but the Spirit is confirming what we're saying. Lord, we want this to be our experience. And so, Lord, grant us your love, that perfect love that casts out fear, insecurity, doubt, worry, anxiety, that we can truly say, it is well with my soul. Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way. Thou art the potter. We are just the clay. Today, if this is your day to give your life to the Lord, our Savior, the Messiah, I want to invite you to come and just meet me here. And you're saying, I want to give my life to the Lord today. I want to accept what has been done for me through the Son of God, the Son of Elohim. Invite you to come, to just come, step out of your seats. If you know you need to accept the Lord, to be baptized, Scripture says, he that believes and is baptized, the same shall be saved. So if the Spirit has spoken to you, now is the accepted time. Now is the day of salvation. Invite you to come. Father, just have your way with each and every one who is here today. Amen. And then finally, as I close, I want to touch and agree with you. And by raising your hand, you will simply be saying, I know someone, my family, my neighbor, my coworker, who I truly want to know the great salvation that is in Christ. In other words, I want them to know Christ. If you know someone, let's just touch and agree. Father, see our hands, oh Lord. We're thinking of relatives. We're thinking of children, grandchildren. We're thinking of neighbors. We're thinking of bosses who may sometimes be ugly. Lord, we may even be thinking of presidential candidates. Lord, nothing's impossible with you. But we just pray for all of these people, Lord. Even as we pray, Lord, I dare to pray about the unrest in our world, the unrest in the Middle East, the unrest in Mali, in Niger, in so many nations of the world. Lord, I can't even name them all. There's over 30 nations where conflicts are going on. Haiti, Lord, and in Ecuador. Lord, people need your peace. Please, Lord. Use us in the sphere, whatever sphere we are in, to be agents of reconciliation, giving people hope to know there's a better way. These blessings we ask in the mighty and matchless name of Yeshua the Messiah, Jesus the Christ. Let all the people of God say amen, amen. And amen and amen. Amen. You may be seated.
just want to praise you.
God bless you, Elder.
Forever and ever and ever.
God bless you.
And glory and honor.
I stood a little bit.
Specialist
is Davidson, man. He's got an 800-page book. I'll get you a copy.
For blessing me. Just want to praise you. Blessings and glory.
What's her name?
And honor. They all belong to you.
How are you making it today?
Thank you, Jesus, for blessing me. Just want to praise you forever.
God bless you. How you doing? Praise
ever.
God.
Yes.
What's up, buddy? How you doing? What's your name?
Blessings and glory.
All right, good to meet you.
And honor.
Show up.
They all belong to you.
Yeah.
Thank you, Jesus, for blessing me. Just wanna praise you.